Move over, hydroxychloroquine. We have a new playboy in town. Ivermectin, a drug that was developed in the 1970s, which to this day is still very safe and effective when it comes to treating head lice and certain parasitic infections. But for COVID, the CDC, the FDA, and the Infectious Diseases Society of America say that it should not be used for COVID unless it's in a clinical trial. But that didn't stop this guy who chose ivermectin over the vaccine. Captain Joe Manning, 57 years old, a Georgia police officer, who frequently posted anti-vax messages on Facebook, died of COVID. Why would some people want a drug that is not FDA approved for COVID because it has not been proven to be safe and effective? Why would someone choose that over something that has been proven to be safe and effective in preventing COVID? Whenever we put something into our body, whether that's drinking something, eating something, taking a pill, or getting a jab, it's important to know three things. One, does it work? Two, is it safe? And three, at what dose does it work and at what dose is it safe? For example, dihydrogen monoxide. That's not something you want to ingest too much of. Why? Because it can cause severe hyponatremia, which leads to brain swelling. And I've seen people actually die in this manner. But on the other hand, we can't live without ingesting dihydrogen monoxide, also known as water. Generally, we should drink 10 to 14 cups per day, depending on various factors. So of course we need water, but do we need ivermectin for COVID? I wish it were the miracle drug. I wish we could have a cheap, safe, and effective drug for treating and preventing this virus. Or saves lives by minimizing the cytokine storm in the body that's brought on by the virus. Well, we do kind of have that with dexamethasone, aka decadron, which is a steroid that is very similar to prednisone. It's the one drug that has the most solid evidence for reducing the severity of COVID illness, including reducing mortality. And it's cheap too, but it's not a miracle drug. So how do we know if ivermectin, one, works? Two, if so, what dose is required for it to work? And three, what is the dose that is safe for ingestion? The ivermectin hype train left the station back in April of 2020, and I talked about that in this video here. It all started with this study that looked at the virus in a test tube when scientists suffocated the virus with massive doses of ivermectin. And surprise, surprise, guess what the results showed? There was a major drop in viral replication. And that's great, right? It's a starting point. It's saying, hey, we might have something here, but there's a problem. The inhibitory concentration of the drug, around 2.5 micromolar, is not achievable in real live humans. In fact, standard ivermectin dosing achieves blood concentrations of about 25 nanomolar. That's 100-fold less than what's needed in vitro based on that one study. Lung concentrations are a bit higher than blood concentrations, but still 50-fold less than what's needed to inhibit the virus in cells in the culture in the test tube. But okay, maybe it works not necessarily by inhibiting viral replication, maybe it can help suppress inflammation from COVID. So you start doing some observational studies. Observational studies are not great studies, but they serve a purpose because you want to see if there's any correlation between ivermectin and its potential to help against COVID. If you see a correlation there, then that warrants spending more time and money to do a bigger, higher quality study in order to prove or disprove that the drug is safe and effective. And the best studies for that are double-blinded, randomized, placebo-controlled trials. The more people in the study, the more you can rely on the results. That's how you prove cause and effect. So you take 30,000 people, you give half of them a placebo, and then the other half the medicine. Then you look at the results, and that's how you get your answer, if it's safe and effective. That's the process that was done with the vaccines. The same cannot be said for ivermectin. Generally speaking, ivermectin, when given in doses used to treat parasitic infections in humans, is very safe. So we're talking about 200 micrograms per kilogram. So for a 75 kilo person, that's around 165 pound person, you're looking at a 15 milligram dose. Before the pandemic, prescriptions for ivermectin in this country were 3,600 per week. Now, they're more than 88,000 per week. But even more concerning is people getting the drug from livestock supply centers where it can come in highly concentrated paste or liquid forms. Sometimes 10 to 15 times the amount that we give people. Well, guess what? Mississippi's health department said that 70% of recent calls to the state poison control center had come from people who ingested ivermectin that came from livestock supply stores. And basically the same thing going on in Alabama. So what are the common symptoms from ingesting too much ivermectin? Nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, but there's also nerve damage that can occur, seizures, and sometimes death. One person drank an injectable ivermectin formulation intended for use in cattle in an attempt to prevent COVID infection. This patient presented to the hospital with confusion, drowsiness, visual hallucinations, tachypnea, meaning breathing fast, and tremors. The patient recovered after being hospitalized for 9 days. Another person took ivermectin tablets of unknown strength purchased on the internet. The patient reportedly took 5 tablets a day for 5 days to treat COVID. The patient was disoriented and had difficulty answering questions and following commands. Symptoms improved with discontinuation of ivermectin after hospital admission. Now, I personally have not seen any patients in the hospital who've had ivermectin toxicity, but I've seen hundreds, if not thousands, of COVID patients. I just finished working a 10-day stretch in the hospital, in the ICU, and every day there are more and more COVID cases. Most of the patients in the ICU were not vaccinated, and I personally have not seen any vaccinated person die of COVID. Also, in the ICU, I haven't seen a single case of someone being hospitalized as a result of the vaccine. Not saying it hasn't happened, but I personally haven't seen it. But that's why we do the studies, right? We want to get big numbers to analyze it. So when it comes to doing studies as far as ivermectin, what do the studies show? A randomized controlled trial was done this past spring and found that ivermectin at a relatively higher dose of 300 micrograms per kilogram had no statistically significant effect on reducing the duration of COVID symptoms. The study also found that there was no statistically significant increase in adverse events for that dose. The Together trial was one of the largest trials studying ivermectin for COVID treatment. It enrolled over 1,300 patients. This study was stopped by the Data Safety Monitoring Board on August 6 because the drug had been shown to be no better than a placebo at preventing hospitalization or prolonged stay in the emergency room. Dr. Mills, who was the leading author of that study, said that they would have actually discontinued it earlier were it not for the level of public interest in ivermectin. But what about this meta-analysis of 24 randomized trials that at first glance looks like it shows that ivermectin helps against COVID? This study analyzed over 3,300 patients in total. 11 out of the 24 trials involved 2,000 patients and had a death rate of 3% in the ivermectin group compared to 8.7% in the comparator arm. This was statistically significant, but the data you get out of a meta-analysis is only as good as the data you put in. If a meta-analysis were a tabletop, it's only solid if it has strong legs to stand on. And some of these legs in this meta-analysis are very shaky, with significant flaws. Some of the collected data was from preprint servers, and some of the collected data was not even published at all. That's a big problem because there's no way to verify the results. Also, individual studies need to be peer-reviewed. Let's look at one of the legs from this meta-analysis. This one out of Iran was hosted on a preprint server. It's a 6-arm randomized trial of patients hospitalized with COVID. But it's wonky. Looking at table 1, 29% of them were PCR negative for the virus. Even worse, this percentage is much higher in the two control groups, 47%, compared to the ivermectin groups of 20%. And this is why there needs to be peer-reviewed studies so that these sorts of things get picked up on. But yet here, this trial is given equal weight to the rest of the legs of the meta-analysis. Another wobbly leg from this meta-analysis is the famous Al-Ghazal trial out of Egypt, in which they compared ivermectin with hydroxychloroquine in 400 people with COVID. The results were pretty dramatic in terms of number of deaths. In the moderately ill group, there were no deaths in the ivermectin group and 4 deaths in the hydroxychloroquine group. Now, in the severely ill group, 2 deaths in the ivermectin group, 20 deaths in the hydroxychloroquine group. But combing through the paper revealed multiple statistically significant imbalances across baseline characteristics. Mistakes are made all the time with research, and that's why these studies need to be peer-reviewed. And if you remove the Iran and the Al-Ghazal studies from Egypt, ivermectin in this meta-analysis, it doesn't look so good. Then there is a more recent review of 14 ivermectin studies with more than 1,600 participants, and it concluded that none provided evidence of the drug's ability to prevent COVID, improve patient conditions, or reduce mortality. The authors of the study wrote, Based on the current very low to low certainty evidence, we're uncertain about the efficacy and safety of ivermectin used to treat or prevent COVID. The completed studies are small and few are considered high quality. Several studies are underway that may produce clearer answers in review updates. Overall, the reliable evidence available does not support the use of ivermectin for treatment or prevention of COVID outside of a well-designed randomized trial. So the biggest disbelief about ivermectin as of right now is that some people would opt for this drug over getting the vaccine. And I'm not saying that there's no hope for ivermectin in the future, but at this point, the evidence just does not show that it works. The good news is that there are multiple large clinical trials going on right now, so soon we'll get a concrete answer one way or another.